Can you all take your seats, please? We need to get started on the session. So we're running behind time. So of course it's important that speakers do try to keep within their allotted times, so that we can finish by one to give you all time for a reasonably leisurely lunch. Okay, so the next speaker is Alexander Sandy Purcell from the University of California at Berkeley, who's been actively researching Xylella since 1971, and more recently, he's combined that with some consulting activities on Xylella. So, Sandy, please.
There you go. Ah, when you turn it on, it worked better? Oh, good. Well, this is the title that I have to work with, and then I have to figure out how to advance it. So, Xylella has long been thought to be restricted to the Americas, and that seems to be changing, however, as we're finding it in more and more places. Italy and France, who will be next? I think we can be certain there will be a next somewhere. We need to be aware, we're of course quite interested in the situation in olive, but it's been discovered in Turkey for some time now, reported from Turkey and for some time now in almond, as well as now Pierce's disease from Iran. So that would be, although olive certainly is a very important crop in its own right, grapevines in terms of its economic impact are even much larger. So I wanted to structure my talk around Xylella fastidiosa, which I've indicated for brevity as XF, around interactions of Xylella with other mainly host plants, and also emphasizing control aspects. So Xylella interacts with more than just the host plant and the environment, as we've heard about, and the vectors, but also other microbes, including other strains of Xylella. And that's an area we need much more information about. Xylella can infect most plant species. And so if you want to just make endless lists of what has been reported to be a host plant in one way or another, it doesn't really provide you with very useful information. You need to know much more than just, is it the host in the broadest sense? And I'll illustrate that shortly. The basis of host specificity among the different strains of Xylella, why that occurs is unknown. And the answer to that question is extremely important. So it's a mystery we need to try hard to solve. One thing we've learned is the cell-to-cell signaling system that Xylella inherited from a common ancestor with its nearest relative, Xanthomonas bacteria, certainly mediates its behavior in the insect vectors and the plant. It's a very complex interaction. But with the ability now to make mutants, to eliminate one by one various genes, we can see that cell signaling is very pivotal in the behavior of whether Xylella causes a disease or, as evolution has designed it, to regulate its own multiplication and movement so as to not cause disease. And somehow this system breaks down when it encounters a plant host that it's never seen in terms of its evolution. Most of the approaches we've tried to use in controlling Xylella spread have attempted, in terms of new control methods, to cure the plant or prevent the plant or introduce resistance, have used genetic constructs or transformed plants that resist the disease in one way or another. And so far, we haven't had really successful any success with this. There's been some promising leads, but they, when you put the plants in the field, it has not held up. Here's an example of Xylella fastidiosa in tobacco. Some varieties of tobacco get severe symptoms, but most of them don't get many symptoms. And yet, the insects can pick it up from these, and so they can be important in that way. This particular slide shows a strain of Xylella transformed to express the green fluorescent protein. And I'd like to point out in the where the arrows show the Xylella coming out. You can see that this is not some random diffusion-like process. This is a very active process. You can see that every one of these pit membranes is occupied by Xylella cells, wiggling its way in through the pit membrane. That's quite a very specific and powerful ability. And it allows the insect or the bacterium to move from cell to cell or vessel to vessel. In one study that we did some 15 years ago, we tested 29 species, mostly of weeds, that occurred commonly where we were concerned in Central California with Pierce's disease of grape. And you see the height of these various bars, which represent different plants, the percent that were infected, the yellow bar, the percent in which we could detect that the bacteria were systemic, that is, they moved a certain distance. Typically, I think we used 20 centimeters as an arbitrary distance we tested them from. So in grape, we got 100% of the plants inoculated were infected, and they were all systemic. But notice that in these other plants, we couldn't detect systemic movement in more than 50% of them, except for a few. But the thing I want to point out that 27 of the 29 species we selected, simply because they grew commonly in vineyards where we were interested in the disease, were positive. So I think it's more useful to not only know were they positive, but were they systemic, and what were the populations reached, because that accounts for vector transmission. Now, in a much older study, in a former student of mine, Barry Hill, we see grape, the different populations that develop in different plants. So we start with 10 to the 7th or 10 million cells per gram of plant tissue after about a week near the inoculation point. And these can reach as high under ideal conditions in a greenhouse, ideal temperature conditions mainly, of a billion cells per gram. So it's not a subtle colonization or infection and producing a disease. Blackberry also reached fairly high populations, no symptoms, but fairly high populations, and it was systemic. Whereas in the watergrass in yellow line, and the red line, mugwort, a common plant, perennial plant in California, it was not systemic, and yet insects could pick it up from that plant. So I think we need to, in our definition of just host plant is not adequate to express the information we really need to assess its role in epidemiology. Well, let me just back up a little bit. I point out also the detection limit at the bottom of that particular slide. It's fairly low, but the number of the population is important to how easily the insects can acquire the bacteria. Now, if we look just within Vitis vinifera, European bunch grapes, some varieties of grapevine, in this case Pinot Noir on the left, Chenin Blanc on the right, quite a difference in tolerance, and yet they all get the bacterium, they all develop disease, and all the varieties seem to be susceptible to being killed by this disease, although it may take many years in the case of the more tolerant ones. If we go to a place with a very high density in terms of genetic diversity, Costa Rica would probably be right at the epicenter of that, a real hotspot for Xylella genetic diversity. This is Len Nunney on the right and William Villalobos on the left in a farm that, much like one that they call Xylella land, because 90% of the plants that they tested were positive. And virtually, we sort of asked the question, we can see that there's a very high incidence of all the plants in Costa Rica are harbor Xylella, and sometimes a diversity, more than one strain in the same plant. I would propose that basically every coffee plant in Central America has Xylella, probably more than one genetic variant in the same plant or the same leaf. If you get a negative from one leaf, just take one on the other side of the plant. Only a few strains seem to cause visible symptoms. Here's a condition they call Crispera. It shows us some sort of curly leaves. And it does have an obvious reduction in yield. All the other plants, they really have no effect, no idea what the reduction in yield might be, because they don't have any uninfected controls to compare it to. So the question is, Xylella in all the plants in Costa Rica? And my answer would be probably. If it's not all, it's probably pretty close. But the native plants are resistant. So this is a theme we go back to again and again, is that it's these new encounters of Xylella, a particular Xylella strain, with some host species it's never seen in terms of its evolution. Like these grapevines in Costa Rica, they're perfectly healthy and they're full of Xylella. Now, by looking at this cell-to-cell signaling system, this can account, as proposed by Lindau and others in his lab at Berkeley, that this cell signaling system allows Xylella to tailor its gene expression according to its circumstances. So it activates a different set of genes early in its colonization of a plant than it would later when the cell signal, a chemical that it produces at some steady rate, reaches a certain level. Then it switches to shutting down its reproduction and slowing down its movement so as to not cause damage to its host. Most of what we're calling symptomless hosts probably do have some reduction in yield or growth, but we've never gone to the extent of carefully measuring that. We'd probably only see it with the use of statistics, not just visualization of symptoms. So this cell signaling system was inherited from Xanthomonas, and like many other aspects of its genome, it's a reduced version of Xanthomonas. It's become an obligate parasite of the xylem system, and so it doesn't need a lot of its genes. But of the 60% or so it has more or less in common with Xanthomonas, sometimes they operate exactly the opposite, like the cell signaling system. If we have a mutant that just produces no signal, in Xanthomonas campestris, it has lessened virulence. In Xylella, it's hypervirulent. And fortunately, it's no longer insect transmitted, and many other genes reduce insect transmission. So what we thought was a fairly simple mechanical process involved in vector transmission, we found we were totally wrong. It's quite a complex situation. Let me move on. So this is something Lindau's lab has been trying to develop, as to exploit this system for control. So that, as we mentioned, if there's no cell signaling, there's hypervirulence in grape. But if you provide the signaling by spraying it on the plant yourself, or injecting it in the plant, or engineering the plant to produce it itself, it does reduce symptoms and the amount of disease. Also, other bacteria can produce related symptoms to which Xylella will respond. So some of these other endophytic bacteria may be a source of reducing disease severity. And again, as I said, direct application is a real possibility. There are many molecular methods proposed, all of which involve genetic engineering of the plant to achieve resistance. So far, none of these have been developed all the way to providing success in field applications. There are a lot of these, some of them have not been published in the formal reviewed literature, scientifically peer-reviewed literature, but they are at this source here, and I'll give you this address, and you can also see it later on the internet. Conventional breeding is coming along. It looks like it's going to be successful in grape, but it's taken 11 years to get to this state. The first breeding attempts were using wild species that are tolerant, perhaps somewhat resistant, but it's a multi-gene sort of resistance and tolerance. Probably more stable, but very difficult to breed into varieties that still have quality grapes. Now they have a single gene that confers immunity, but that may not be stable in terms of its use in the field over many years. The molecular methods available now, I won't dwell on these. You can look them up later. You can look up in this particular reference. But they start out with looking at various mutants of identified genes suspected to be of some usefulness. And indeed, most of these methods have not developed to fulfillment, or they still have some promise and are still being developed, but have not yet succeeded. The conventional breeding, on the other hand, has used genes from wild relatives, making the hybrids with vinifera and other wild species, and then continual backcrossing of each hybrid generation to the parent. And they've come up with some pretty good blind tastings give you something that people don't differentiate from Cabernet Sauvignon. They're 97% vinifera. So they can identify some of these that may be better quality than others. Certainly they will be. There are different dangers of using a single gene for resistance, however. How about Xylella's interactions with the environment? Temperature has been already raised. That's something that's interested me for a long time. And environmental effects are quite key with Pierce's disease, where this has been studied. I've studied it the most. Curiously, maximum temperatures haven't been looked at, and it was very interesting to see Maria's results on the fall in populations in the summer. You notice the temperature, max temperature, is pretty low, 34 centigrade. It gets up 40 degrees for prolonged periods in Puglia. So it's interesting. I wonder if it couldn't be too hot, but it doesn't look like it can be. This is a very old slide made probably 30-something years ago when I drew this up. And we had a lot of questions about how it occurred in Texas. Those have now been fleshed out in greater detail. And this is work from Texas scientists just based on their familiarity of where the disease occurs. Now, it was the point was raised earlier today that they found the disease, or Xylella, in oak as far north as Canada. But note that that's a very rare finding, and that once a chronically infected plant occurs in a cold area, it does tend to survive the winter better. Here's a map that shows the red line below which, to the south of that line in Georgia, Alabama, South Carolina, and so forth, right on the Atlantic coast. As you go up in elevation, the winter temperatures are colder and the occurrence of Pierce disease is much less prominent. With the warning that if you have an extremely mild winter, then you're going to have a lot more disease that next growing season. And that's their experience. So being very speculative about this, how can we extend this sort of correlation of minimum average January temperature, for example, which was used to create this map? What if we extended that to Europe? We see that Apulia, the heel of Italy, is particularly seems risky. That seems to match pretty well. but we won't see the rest of the story until much later. And also, it's very risky to apply this to draw such a map of risk assessment, because the date of infection with Pierce's vines to cause Pierce disease, that rate of recovery depends on when you inoculated the vine. So this graph shows you that from 100 to 130 something days after the first of the year, as we get into late May or early June, infections made after that date will recover. And you'll notice the exceptions, the triangles in this graph, are at Parlier, and that's in the Central Valley, the southern part of the Central Valley, where they have much milder winters than the other areas where these experiments, field experiments, were made. So recovery seems to be a very important point. And the point I'd like to make here is we have no idea how this occurs. I mean, don't we want to understand something that completely cures a plant? Of course we do. And we have no idea why that is. So there's a topic that could help us all. It could open the door to many other therapies. I mean, many other stresses besides freezing might cause this. One thing we do know is that just freezing itself in vitro doesn't kill enough xylella to be explain how that causes recovery. With any new epidemic of xylella so far, the first people to show up are from the fertilizer companies, and they've got a miracle cure. And I think we're starting to find in Apulia in Italy, claims for miracle cures are not standing up to scientific scrutiny. So the early claims, we shouldn't ignore them. They may be true. It would be great if they were. But unfortunately, they are not. And they upset growers when you try to tell them that it needs to be tested. It can't be accepted on faith after a few months. I want to move on now quickly to vectors. Here's a vector on the left, a leafhopper that's a xylem feeding specialist. It feeds on the plants infected with the bacteria and transmit it to other plants like grape, then causes a particular disease. It's spread in the plant. And we find, as the point has been made, I won't dwell on, any sap feeding specialist is probably a vector, various efficiency, depending on the plant it's feeding on. Transmission involves the foregut, which would explain why when the insect molts its skin, it no longer can transmit, but can quickly reacquire the bacteria. And in a breakout session today, I'll briefly discuss in more detail how the numbers of vectors, along with their transmission efficiency and how often they move around, how that might affect the rate of infection. So we have a variety of insects. The cicadas have been little studied, and because of their prominence in Europe, Southern Europe, that they need to be extensively studied as vectors. I'm just going to go through this quickly. Again, as I mentioned, it's the not only the number of the infective vectors, but how many are infective and how efficient they are in transmitting and how often do they move. So let's take two examples. One was, I showed you a picture before of the blue-green sharpshooter, very efficient transmitter from and to grape, 80-90% per insect per day in laboratory tests. Glassy-winged sharpshooter, which has a lot of notoriety because it was an invasive species introduced into California in the early 90s, perhaps even earlier, but became a problem in vineyards in Southern California. And when we tested it as a vector, it was much less efficient. But if you actually look at the field data, here is a buildup of disease over a number of years in an insect that moves in the spring, infective insects, because it overwinters an adult. So the infective adults that move into vineyards concentrate their disease near the riparian or riverbank vegetation. Where a glassy-winged sharpshooter has occurred, it's really caused a lot faster damage. It'll cause this damage in just 3 years instead of what you previously saw was an accumulation probably of 10 years of disease spread. So by it, taken by itself, transmission efficiency is not the only criteria that's important. And so blue-green sharpshooter, you need to control populations next to vineyards, or not plant vineyards next to these situations. Whereas glassy wing sharpshooter, you need to eliminate it from source areas. So where it's a problem is where it comes out, mainly out of, in California, out of citrus groves. That's where it overwinters. It comes into nearby vineyards, and that's where you have the spread. Citrus is one of those rare plant species that is in no way a host in any fashion of Xylella. Otherwise, the infection rate of the vector would be very high, so it must undoubtedly pick it up from grapes 1 year, carry it through the winter as an adult the next year. Whereas the blue-green sharpshooter does the same thing, but it will breed and reproduce in grape, and yet its primary spread in the spring is what's important, because the later vine-to-vine movement of the bacteria is of no consequence to establishing chronic disease. So vector control, despite 15 years of investing $4 or $5 million a year on Xylella research for Pierce's disease, mostly in California, vector control really is our main means of control or limiting disease spread. So field work is really important. It's not as romantic and sexy as some of the molecular methods, which are extremely exciting scientifically, but as far as practical control, vector control is quite important. What works in California does not work at all in the southeastern U.S. They just have, their vineyards are too small, they're full of weeds because of the high rainfall, they can't really do much about that, and they have a lot of vectors at all times in the growing season. Florida has, if we want to look at other Xylella strains as cross protectants, Florida has weakly systemic but not very virulent in grape isolates that do provide cross protection in Florida but doesn't seem to work in California. And a problem is, do you want to import another strain of Xylella to use as a protective? I don't think so, because it probably is going to cause disease in something else. Genetically modified strains as a cross protectant. That shows some promise, but it's still preliminary. Other microbes, I'm quite excited by looking for other endophytic bacteria and investigating their possible impacts. But so far, I think this is a wide open field for you to look at in Europe, although we ought to be looking at it in Costa Rica. Bacteriophage, very exciting report very recently of curing vines with Pierce's disease. But still, this is a lab phenomenon. We don't know how durable it will be. And do you really want to import new phage? We know that temperate phage, definitely, those are prophage that incorporate in the genome, are quite adept at carrying around genetic material. So they could change the genotype of Xylella in a new environment so that they would evolve to perhaps cause more damage in plants that right now aren't damaged. So that's some precaution we need to take. So I'd like to end my talk on just pointing out that a lot has been done on Xylella, and even more has not been done. One thing we've done in North America, to sum up the state of the art, is that we've discovered a lot of things that don't work, and we've discovered even greater number of things we don't know. So I admonish you to learn from our past mistakes and build on some of our advances instead of having to reinvent them yourself. Someone said reinventing the wheel. So here's a early experiment in transportation with people that invented themselves a wheel, but you see they're ready to launch that to see what happens, and they're going to have a very unpleasant finding what happens to the guys roped to it. So we don't want to reinvent the wheel, but at the same time, in looking back in the history of research on Xylella, all of the really major breakthroughs are made by naive investigators. Now, by naive, I don't mean stupid. I mean that they just don't know about it. And so they do things that an experienced investigator like myself wouldn't think of doing, because they know you can't do that. They don't know that yet. And they discover, yeah, you can do that. So again, I'll leave you with this, I think. Yeah, I want to thank you for inviting me, and I look forward to talking to as many of you as I can. Let's see, there we go. So if you're interested in that particular reference, it's useful because it includes a lot of negative data, which is normally not published, and I think that might be useful. Also, you'll see the very latest projects being funded and investigated. And not just in California, but mostly in California, because the program is aimed at Pierce's disease in North America. It's also, these reports are progress reports. They're not edited, they're not reviewed, so they tend to be a little bit raw, let's say. But I think a useful place to start your investigation.
Thank you very much, Sandy. So we have time for some questions.
No?
No one wants to admit to their mistakes? Ah, Stefan.
Stefan Winter from Germany. So I'm a bit puzzled by this endophyte that can switch. So you think that the bacteria in itself, being an endophyte in one plant, then switches to become a pathogen? Into a systemic phase, a symptomatic phase?
Well, it's an endophytic in all of its plant host. It lives only in the xylem. And I'm talking, when I say host, I really mean a systemic multiplying host. But it will switch its behavior in the same plant depending on whether it's early in the infection or later in the infection. And whether it's in a vector or a plant, different genes are uploaded rather than expressed downward. Does that answer your question?
For being a host, does a bacteria need to move? Is movement required?
Yes. I don't know of any exceptions to that.
Yeah. Yeah, this is Emilio Montesinos from the University of Girona in Spain. You said that injections of bactericides didn't work against Pierce disease. Can you tell what types of bactericides have been tested?
Mostly the antibiotic tetracycline. You do get a decrease in symptoms, but when you stop giving it tetracycline, the symptoms come back. It doesn't cure the plant. Copper, different forms of zinc and copper have been tried, no real success other than killing a few grapevines, but not Xylella. So there's certainly room for exploration there, but so far everything tried has not been promising.
Okay, last one, Jan?
Yes, I have a question. Oh, my name is Jan van der Wolf. I'm from Wageningen in the Netherlands. And I have a question about the thermotherapy. You spoke about the optimum and the maximum growth temperature, but what is the temperature which is lethal to the bacteria?
Okay, yeah. Heat therapy is you come up with a nice time temperature curve. Below that line, you have no recovery. Above it, you get excellent recovery. So this is in the literature. I don't have any numbers right on my head, but temperatures which dormant cuttings of grapevine survive very well will completely eliminate and confidently eliminate all the living xylella. It's been quite successful. So as a precautionary movement for movement of material, of course, you have to use dormant cuttings. It's very useful.
Okay, so thank you very much, Sandy. So now we move to the next speaker, who this time comes from South America, Xiao Lopez. and he will give his presentation on the ecological basis for management.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? Well, first, thanks for the invitation. It will be a pleasure to share some information we have for Xylella in Brazil and South America. I work for University of São Paulo. My expertise is on transmission of plant pathogens by vectors, especially fastidious bacteria, Xylella, Liberibacter, some phytoplasmas. But I have been working mostly with Xylella in a number of years. My goal here is to present some ecological and epidemiological information about Xylella in Brazil, especially, that helps to establish management programs. We focus on citrus variegated chlorosis. So diseases caused by Xylella in South America are citrus variegated chlorosis, coffee leaf scourge, and plant leaf scald. The first one was detected in 1935, plant leaf scald, initially in Argentina. And then years later, in the 70s, it was reported in southern Brazil. And it's a very aggressive disease, causes leaf scourge, death of the plants after some years. Today, it's distributed in many areas. In Brazil, all the plant grower regions have this bacteria. It's really limiting the production in some areas. The second disease was citrus variegated chlorosis, found in 87 in São Paulo. This disease causes leaf chlorosis, variegated chlorosis, and reduces fruit size, some plant stunting. And years later, they detected this Xylella in coffee. When they are looking for alternative hosts of Xylella in other plants besides citrus, they found that coffee was had many Xylella. And it was also causing a disease in coffee, characterized by leaf scourge, but mostly a stem atrophy with leaf drop, shortening of internodes, and also reduction in fruit size. A lot of progress has been done on Xylella. Most studies and research have focused on this disease in citrus variegated chlorosis. But the beginning, the information was slow. It was very difficult in the beginning to work with this bacteria. It took a long time, about 6 years, from discovery of the disease until fulfillment of the Cox postulate. So initially, when they first found the disease, they thought it was some nutritional problem related to deficiency of some nutrients. Then the evidence for a pathogen came a few years later when they could get graft transmission of a pathogen. In the 1990s, they found the Xylella fastidiosa-like cells in the xylem. In 1993, they were able to isolate in France the bacterium and inoculate and produce disease. So took 6 years until the fulfillment of Cox postulates. And then management and others, research on vectors started. And we could evolve in managing this disease. Spread was kind of fast. So in 1987, it was restricted to a few areas in Brazil, in northern São Paulo and Minas Gerais. But in 1994, it was already in epidemic level and present in many Brazilian states. And the spread was mainly by nursery trees, infected nursery trees, because in São Paulo, many nursery producers were located. Today, all citrus regions in Brazil have the problem, and also Argentina and Paraguay have reported the disease. A new leaf scourge disease was found in olive associated with Xylella fastidiosa. There was a recent report in Argentina. And now, Elvesio Coleta Filho, who is here, he was able to isolate Xylella from plants with similar symptoms in Brazil. And so it's a new disease probably caused by Xylella. So epidemiology is very important to manage the disease. Understanding how the system works provides a basis for establishing effective management and also helps to set guidelines for research, especially control-oriented research. So we need to learn how the system works, host plants, vector, pathogens, and also the environmental conditions that favor these relationships. Xylella are pathosystems are usually complex. They have multiple host plants. They have many vectors, generally polyphagous species. You have pathogen genetic variation. You have these environmental factors that can influence both infection and symptom expression. So there is plenty of a field for many people to study. In South America, we have two subspecies of Xylella causing disease, so CVC and cough leaf scourge caused by palca, whereas plant leaf scald is caused by multiplex, but we have been isolating palca from infected plants. This phylogeny was built based on multi-local sequence type data. This is a work done by Rodrigo Almeida and Elvesio, so they kindly provided me this slide. But briefly shows that all isolates from coffee, citrus that we have in Brazil belongs to palca. The plan, we have isolates that belong to palca and also from multiplex, but predominantly from multiplex. And there is variation in these isolates within palca, within in citrus and coffee. And recent new sequence types have been identified. And this is part of a new work that will be published by Elvesio and Rodrigo. It's important to know that although this citrus and coffee strains within palca that cause disease in coffee and citrus are closely related, they appear to be biologically different. In studies where we have reciprocal inoculations of many isolates from coffee and citrus, we don't get cross-infection. For example, citrus isolates inoculated in coffee plants, usually we don't get infection and nor symptoms. When you inoculate coffee isolates, you don't get infection and symptoms in coffee, with a few exceptions. So in general, they do not cross infect. They're different. Concerning vectors, we have a high diversity of phloem and of xylem fluid feeders in Brazil, as is, this picture is more or less the same in South America, like in Costa Rica, Central America. We have many groups of xylem feeders. But the most the diverse is the Cicadellini leafhoppers, also known as sharpshooters, belonging to two tribes. Only in citrus orchards in São Paulo state, 25 genera of these sharpshooters have been found. And besides some cercopods too, there are primarily grass feeders. Transmission experiments have been done to demonstrate the ability to transmit. And out of 17 sharpshooters tested, 13 were able to transmit. In plan, we already have data indicating 3 species, and coffee, 4 species. in citrus, the vectors are divided in two tribes, Cicadellini and Procorini. So you have most of them are Cicadellini, are more diverse, and the others are in Procorini. It's interesting that citrus and coffee in Brazil, they are associated, especially in southeastern. So they have many vectors in common. Sampling sharpshooters in coffee and citrus, we find many species that are found in the two crops. So they can really move from one crop to another. And we also find that this is the vector species composition, although it's very similar between crops in the same region, it can vary drastically if you move to other regions for the same crop. For example, when you did a study on vector species composition in São Paulo and another in a distant region, you know, in the northeastern Brazil, we found a different species composition. In São Paulo state, basically, four species are predominant in most cases. Acrogonia, Bucephalogonia, Dilobopterus, Oncometopia. But if you go to citrus orchards in the northeastern region, you find among the prevalent species others. Only Acrogonia citrina was common to both situations. So this tells that surveys of potential vectors are usually needed for each new region or crop threatened by Xylella fastidiosa. And because there is low specificity within xylem feeders, as these transmission experiments have shown, we can expect a broad vector range. So many regions and crops have potential vectors in place to spread as Xylella fastidiosa strain. So I mean, many times you don't need an invasive vector. So you may already have the vectors in place to spread the bacteria. Concerning transmission mechanisms, some studies have been done in collaboration with Alberto Ferreres and some students, and we have studied penetration activities associated with acquisition and inoculation of Xylella in citrus by this vector Bucephalogonia shuntoffs. We did this using this electropenetration graph technique. It's a very specialized technique where electro waveforms are correlated with specific feeding activities of the insect on the plant, such, for example, salivation and movement of stylets through the epidermis and parenchyma. This X waveform, which is silent contact, XI is silent ingestion. So we know where the bugs are when they are performing these waveforms. So we found that acquisition occurs only during ingestion, as expected, but inoculation was observed before that, during stylet pathway phase and xylem phase. This was kind of surprising to us. And this is the time for these activities to be performed. So the time from start of the probing until xylem contact or ingestion is on average around 30 minutes for this specific sharpshooter. But it can vary from 2.5 minutes to 100 minutes. So it can be very short or takes a little longer than 1 hour. So in general, acquisition occurs only during xylem sap ingestion. It may be less than 1 hour, but inoculation may occur before. We still need to study this further. Yeah? Concerning overall transmission mechanisms, the few studies that have been done in Brazil show that apparently it's the same as it was already shown in California with the vectors in grapevines. In terms of interaction of the bacteria with the vector, we have found cells attached to the foregut, specifically to the pre-Siberian and the Siberian pump. These are pictures of Xylella with vectors from citrus, so presence of bacterial biofilms in the pre-Siberian and Siberian, and also in the diaphragm membrane in the Siberian pen. Concerning host plants, of vectors and xylella, studies that have been done in Brazil, have indicated that xylella can colonize the crops and also some ornamental and wild host plants. The vectors are found in several habitats. So besides citrus, coffee, we have found the sharpshooters in many natural habitats, especially wood habitats, nearby these crops. Search done in these habitats have indicated the presence of many natural hosts of these sharpshooters. These are four of the most abundant sharpshooters on citrus, and only for those species we found around 40 species in 20 different families. So they are polyphagous, and they can carry xylella among these different habitats and plants. Some of these natural hosts were tested for xylella infection by mechanical inoculation, and three of them came out positive. But we did some collections of materials in the field and never got any infection on plants that were visited by sharpshooters. Some studies investigated the weed hosts of xylella in orchards, for example, in citrus orchards. This is a study by Silvio Lopez. And quite a few grasses and other species were found to be naturally infected, and they also could get inoculation of xylella of a citrus strain and infection of these plants. Same type of study was done in plant orchards, and this study showed that the bacteria was naturally present on this plant, and also if you inoculate some of them, you could get infection. So as Sandy Purcell stressed, many of these plants are infected. But what we need to do now is to have more transmission experiments done with acquisition on this plant to see whether they can really work as inoculant sources. Based on what we know on citrus, the inoculant source that we know is citrus. It's an important inoculant source. And both primary and secondary spread takes place. So primary spread happens when you have a neighbor orchard, infected orchard. So the vector comes from this orchard, usually nearby, and brings the bacteria to the other orchard. And secondary happens also very often, secondary spread. So you may have sharpshooters picking up the bacteria in one plant and then transmit it to the other. So both forms of spread occur. But limited information is available on other sources of inoculant outside citrus. Because citrus is an important source of inoculant, sharpshooters that feed on citrus are considered key pests, key vectors, like these four. Xylella and the vectors have a strong interaction with the environment, as has been told in the previous talks. In São Paulo, this is easily shown. For example, the incidence of the disease has a difference depending on the part of the state. In the northern and northwest part of São Paulo state, you have high incidence of Xylella fastidiosa, and actually of CVC, of the disease. And as you go south, the incidence decreases. The northern environment is characterized by a water stress. There is a very long dry season, much longer than in the south. And you have warmer temperatures. That has an impact on the sharpshooter populations. Based on the biology, we can predict a larger number of generations per year in the northern region because of the higher temperatures. On the other hand, if you analyze latent infections, those infections that the bacteria is present in the plant but not show symptoms, you see an inverse trend. You do get infected plants in the south, but they don't show symptoms. In most cases, in the south region, you get asymptomatic infections. No disease is seen. Whereas in the north, you see the majority of infections will produce disease. So it's So both incidence and CVC severity are environmentally dependent. Another thing is the infection periods, when infection takes place in citrus. So investigations have been done in this area by looking, by putting trap plants or bait plants in the citrus orchards. These plants are put on the orchard for a month, and then every month they are replaced and take to the greenhouse and look for symptoms and infection. So infection occurs most of the year. The only period we didn't see infection was in the winter, but in most cases in spring and summer. And this is the time when you have more vegetation in the orchards, and also when the vectors are most commonly found on citrus trees. So based on all this information, management of CVC is done considering a tripod. There are three major strategies. So health, nursery trees is the basis for that. So all the materials from other trees, budwoods, the rootstocks are produced within containment in protected screen houses. And there is a certification program in the state. So all the citrus nurseries must be inspected so that the nursery trees are healthy. And you don't introduce the disease in the orchard when you plant. Pruning and roguing is another strategy to remove inoculum that is in the orchard. So they are important strategies too. And vector control would be the other part. So vector control can be done with different strategies. You can do like application of systemic insecticides by trunk and soil applications. But they only work in two situations, when the plants are young, up to 3 years. Because when they are older, there is no translocation of the insecticides to the young leaves. And this happens only during the rainy season, so in the beginning of the spring and summer. In the other times of the year, and also for older plants, the only thing that kills the vectors are contact insecticides. So you have to spray the plants, the top part of the plants. The disease management depends on inspection for eradication of infected plants. So you need to analyze the plants in the orchard at least once a year, preferably two. Usually late in the summer or fall when the symptoms are obvious in citrus. Any plant that show a systemic infection in young orchards, plants that are less than 3 years old, must be eliminated because in this age, the bacteria is already systemic in the plant. And insecticide treatments in young orchards are done systematically to prevent infection. In older orchards, this inspection of disease plants, they continue. But in that case, if you find symptoms, initial symptoms, you can do pruning. Because in this case, the bacteria may not be so well systemically invading the plant. So these are level one symptoms. Just localize the plant, a few leaves in the plant. When you detect early, you can prune. Otherwise, if you find many, many branches with symptoms, the plants must be eliminated. This is called level two. Vector control in other orchards is done with insecticide applications during periods of higher vector population, which is spring, summer, and fall, and also with higher infection rates. And also, yellow stick cards are used in these older orchards, especially in areas nearby, in the borders of the field, when there is higher chance of income of vectors. In general, these management strategies, they have been used for many years already. And for a long time, the incidence of CVC continued very high, around 35 and 40%. Just recently, there was a decrease, So in the last 4 years, there was a drop, sharp decrease of CVC incidence from 37 to 6%. So it's very good news. What we think is happening is that you see this incidence of Huanglongbin. So the citrus growers are very scared about Huanglongbin. It's caused by Liberibacter, transmitted by psyllids. So they are making a very strict chemical control for the psyllids, much more strict than they use it for sharpshooters. And now the eradication of orchards are very intense. Many orchards are being eliminated, old orchards. And also we have the health nursery trees. So the combination of all these strategies done very strictly are reducing CVC incidence, finally. But the new challenges now are sustainability. So far, all the strategies have focused on the pathogen, like exclusion, eradication, and on chemical control of the vector. So this is not, especially the chemical control is not sustainable in the way it's being done, like every week or 2 weeks they are spraying for the seeds. So we need more sustainable approaches, selective insecticides that preserve natural enemies, biological control. There are some egg parasitoids that can be explored. There are entomopathogenic fungi that are effective against these insects that could be used. And also, interactions should be targeted. This is something that has not been done much. So based on immunization, relationship between host and pathogen should be better studied for resistance. Interaction between vector and host plants. So there are many approaches that could be used trying to disrupt the arrival of the vector on the crop, so disrupting behavior. And also transmission could be a target too. It could affect maybe acquisition or retention of the bacteria in the vector. So there's a lot of opportunities for research. And another thing is area-wide management. This is very important. We are learning this with Huanglongbin in Brazil. And the same applies to Xylella, because there is primary spread. So if one grower does the job and the neighbors don't do it, usually it doesn't work. So everybody must do it in a single region. So this is very important for everything to work. But it's very difficult to implement, because you need cooperation from others. Another thing is to associate different strategies. We don't know of any strategies that is 100% efficient. For example, in vector control, some things could be associated, like making plants less attractive to the insects, or association with threat plants. We learned that if you change the color of citrus, the sharpshooters don't like it. They don't land on citrus. For example, if you have an orchard and you have a source of vectors outside, you could use this changing in coloration in some rows of trees nearby. You could use trap plants, plants that are very attractive, more attractive than citrus. There are some that are. You could plant them and then treat them with insecticides. The insects would land first on these trap plants. They would not enter the field because there is this repellents, and they would be killed here. So this is an example of integration that could be tried in Brazil. So there are many things to be done. Among the research gaps, I think there is a lack of epidemiology and management information for the other diseases, such as plant leaf scald and cough leaf squirt. We don't know anything in these crops. Ecology of Xylella fastidiosa and vectors outside crops is barely understood. We know very little about what happens with the vectors and the bacterium outside, if there are inoculum sources that can be inoculum reservoirs, especially now that they are eradicating Xylella from the orchards in Brazil. And bio-rational methods for vector control. We need alternative approaches. And I think this is possible. I would like to acknowledge funding agencies that have provided support to these projects. The results I presented here are not only from my lab, but from many collaborating labs too. So we have collaborations with other people that work with Xylella. And also the results of many dissertations and theses from former graduate students. Thank you very much. If you have the chance to go, have a chance to go to Brazil, you are welcome to visit my lab.
Okay, so there's time for some questions. Jean-Claude
Grégoire, Université Libre de Bruxelles. It's a question to both speakers, but actually it was triggered by something you said, Dr. Lopez. You said that most xylem sap feeding insects are potential vectors, and you did not say all sap feeding insects. And so I was wondering, are there known documented cases of species which have never been observed to carry the bacteria, even though they inhabit areas which are colonized by Xylella?
Yes, there are some cases. For example, there are some sharpshooters that we tested extensively in large numbers. For example, there is a grass feeder, Hortensia simidis. This sharpshooter is common from Argentina to southern United States. We tested several times, putting on citrus plants, and they do not transmit to other citrus plants. But maybe it's not because it is not a vector or cannot acquire the bacteria. Maybe because of the feeding preferences. Maybe it doesn't like citrus at all. It doesn't feed it at all like citrus. So vector competence, ability to acquire and retain, can be determined by intrinsic characteristics of the vector, retention, but also by behavior, host plant preferences. And this can change. So if you test the Hortensia simidis in another situation with another crop, you can get positive results. So this has to be done forever system.
Hello. My name is Kouboulis. I'm from Greece, from the National Agricultural Research Center. I would like to ask whether you have noticed any difference in the spread of the pathogen according to the orchard management, for example, intensively managed farms compared to non-intensively managed farms, organic compared to conventional, weed-free soil compared to farms with weeds, and the high biodiversity weeds compared to no weeds at all or poor biodiversity in the orchard. Do you have any indications about the effect of such factors on the spread of the pathogen?
Yeah, I'm not sure if that we have enough information to say about all these factors you mentioned. Some things are clear, like the temperature, stress, water stress. But concerning like vegetation, ground vegetation, apparently the evidence we have so far is that the weeds are not so important like for primary spread. So based on the evidence we have so far is that if you change that, you may not have a great impact. But irrigation, for example, can have an impact because irrigation gives humidity. The experience has shown that although humidity does not, for example, promote more severe symptoms. Humidity allows better infection. There is some data showing that the bacteria goes well when you have a supply of water and the vectors also. So we have to study many of these things. There are not many studies varying these cropping systems and.
Presentating from the University of Bologna, Italy. I was wondering, you presented the starting of the infection with one long bean and the decreasing of Xylella. Is there any relationship here? I am. Is there any relationship between the management you are adopting for Xylella and the emerging of the one long bean? Because it's a similar situation also in other, in Mexico, in South America. The one long bean is rising and the Xylella is decreasing.
Yeah, there is a clear relationship because the methods, the control methods are basically the same. So Huang Long Bean, when got established in Brazil, these strategies for controlling Xylella were already in place. And the basic methods, because the epidemiology is more or less similar, you get primary spread and secondary spread. The vectors came from outside sources, from other neighboring orchards. So the control, the insecticides are similar. They are effective, even more effective for sharpshooters than for psyllids in general. So that's why you have suppression of the vectors of CVC. And also because the growers are really eradicating older orchards. With Xylella, what happens is that the growers had an infected tree. Many growers knew that plants are infected, but it's still getting production for some time. So they were kind of, just keeping the inoculum. But with Huang Long Bean, people just remove everything when they find. They try to, at least. Some, not all of them.
Okay, I think this will have to be the last question.
Xilo Yannis from Italy. You pointed out the importance of orchard management, especially sustainability, to control Xylella. And particularly when we know the first symptoms of so pruning and water stress and nutritional. And so we can take into consideration all this sustainability, how to manage the orchard, to avoid the cutting of the old trees. I'm asking you.
Yeah. If you talk about, if you think epidemiologically, you should cut, you should remove the inoculant sources because it's very clear that if you keep them, the vectors keep visiting this plant, they will.
At the beginning.
Yeah, if you find the, if you do regular inspections, you can remove the inoculant. The vectors, it's not guaranteed that the vectors will not acquire before that, but I think it's something that can be done.
Okay, thanks very much.
So Giovanni Cantele is representing Copacogeca, the Association of the Farmers and Agro-Cooperative in Europe. He is chairman of the farmer association called Diretti in Apulia, and is a wine producer from Apulia. So will talk to us from a different perspective, which are the needs of research from a farmer point of view.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for invitation. It's a great pleasure to represent European farmers and Copacogeco. I face every day this situation because I come exactly from Puglia, exactly from the place where we are having the biggest problems. And frankly speaking, this is the very first time that I hear to talk about these problems outside home, and it seems to me that we are really in big troubles. But this is I'm just kidding because I'm totally aware that we are probably, especially in Puglia and southern Puglia, facing probably the worst trouble that could be possible to add. So my presentation is just okay. So the very first slide is just to describe what is happening, what's the meaning of this these problems. I don't need to describe everything because both for Italy and France has been already made a clear situation. But I want to stress that in Puglia is the second largest Italian region in terms of utilized agriculture area. And this means about 3 million euro of gross sellable products production. So olive trees is a main crop in this in my region, with around 43 million olive trees, mostly age old. And I want to stress this part, saying that for this reason, most of the problems, in order to have, I think, a proper managing of this situation, is due to the fact that these are not just plants; these are monuments; these are the history of this land. So we have to take into account this. This sector provides many jobs, of course. And is an important source of economic activity, and worth about roughly 500 million euro of GSP. So which is very important. And as you know, Xylella fastidiosa appeared in was detected in Salento in October in the October 2013. In France, in the previous speech, the situation is fortunately less difficult than in Puglia, because it's involving only mainly ornamental plants. But I think, and I'm sure, that also in that country, growers are now very worried for the future of their own job. So, further main crops, potentially also of Xylella fastidiosa, we have hundreds of both ornamental plants and botanical spices, including almond and cherry, which are very important in Puglia, a very important crop and also traditional crop, and also peach. Citrus and vitis are still in the list of prohibited movement plants in Puglia, but waiting to be excluded. And I strongly hope that also this situation can be cleared very soon. In the previous speech of Maria Saponari, there was the proof that sampling from the field didn't show any problems with the vines. Now we are waiting for the pathogenic trials on the vines. I'm stressing on this because we have a smaller problem in the bigger problem, which is the dormant cutting nursery, which are very important in the south of Puglia, and there are lots of farmers that they are now they don't have the opportunity to sell their production, and so we strongly hope that using the maximum level of prudence, and so this means also the hot treatment, we may tell something of positive to those people. Considering global market development, we regret that the European Commission has failed in implementing an effective control system to prevent imports from third countries where Xylella problem was already identified. In the Xylella fastidiosa crisis management, the reaction in stopping imports of host plants from notice countries for the specified organism was not prompt enough. I cannot avoid to stress also this, because even if the movement of the plants, involved plants, was stopped with the first commission decision, not the same as being applied with the importation from third countries. And this happened after more than 1 year, and I think it was a very, at least I think, not rational approach to the problem, especially if we take, if we know that previously there were, during the French, the French colleague speech, there was has been stated that in 2012 there was a problem. So I think that in terms of protecting the European border from the importation of alien disease, I think we have a problem. So Xylella fastidiosa is the most serious risk for the UE under several points of view: social and economic impact, environmental impact, and loss of biodiversity, because this, I think, is another big problem. Most of the investment, the European investment, are in the last years and in the next years directed into the protection of biodiversity. We probably have a big problem there in order to achieve this target. So in terms of containment of the outbreak, we believe it is imperative to firstly ensure that the farmers outside these regions will not be impacted by the outbreak. So this is obviously is the first thought that any farmer outside the place where the problem is now such a big problem, and we have to defend this. Establish effective measures to control the spread of disease. And effective measures, I think, it is necessary to evaluate very very rationally every kind of measure that we will need to take in the next future. Defend other major crops. I talked about them in a previous slide. And I also think that farmers need to show responsibility in organic integrated strategy against vector controls. This is probably considering what we know and what we what the situation we have in that part of Italy. I think that it is very important to make this kind of to achieve the best results in terms of vector control, and proper and regular agronomic practices. This means pruning, much frequent pruning, but this also means higher cost, because this means that especially where the old age trees reflect the or are an expression of the landscape, but for this reason they are much more expensive in terms of taking this kind of attention. Eradication of infected plants. This is for sure is an option, but I think, and it is quite clear in during this meeting, that we need to use this kind of measure in a proper way. Considering global market development, the Commission should analyze social costs, because we will have, for sure, in every place where Xylella fastidiosa will affect the production, the agriculture production, we will face job losses. So this is a fact, and we have to take this clearly in our mind. Economic consequence, cost of grabbing up, if necessary, and loss of income for several years, because this not happen only if we have to make grabbing up our trees, but there are large areas in Puglia where the problem is already present. There are farmers that this year are starting the third year that they are not able to make any olive harvest. So this is a big problem. Environmental impacts, soil erosion for sure, and the loss of carbon sinks. But I also need to stress the fact that where the olive crops are represented, where we have trees that are not only trees, this make a big impact on the tourism point of view, and this is another loss of economy in the place where this happened. So I believe that as a result, the Commission should compensate income losses for farmers so they can make it through this difficult period for the immediate. But for instance, the Commission should seek possible alternatives for farmers to restore and reconvert their productive potential within the framework of rural development funds. But we also believe that it is we have to do as much as possible in order to protect and in order to preserve the capacity for the growers to produce the same crop. So olive trees. We want to try to find the solution to make Puglia is the first region in Italy to in order regarding the production of olive oil, especially extra virgin olive oil. But we trust in EU research. Horizon 2020 is a great opportunity in social challenge too, but more funds, we believe that more funds are required, and also a full integrated network are needed. I think that the keyword must be working in synergy, so to achieve the best results. This is the wishing list. I know perfectly that is. I heard with lots of attention the previous speech. So, research priorities: resistant clones. We choose to avoid the GMO way, but also Professor Purcell explained that a different way is possible, and we hope so that it is possible to find something. Curative solutions, vectors antagonists, alternative crops, and renaturalization projects. I think that also this is very important because if olive trees are in that area, it is not just because people centuries ago decided to plant there because they wanted to do this, but because nothing else could be possible to do. So when we are not able to plant again, we have to find a solution in order to make the environment to go back into a good environment situation. So we can imagine that Puglia, the olive trees in Puglia are like a wood in any other kind of in any other place in the world. And when we lose olive trees, we lose so much in terms of carbon and so on. So The other idea is a Salento open field lab. What does it mean? Best practice trial to be used to properly manage any further possible disease situation. So this can be the best practice that is possible to have ready to be used in any other situation. Because I think that also for the conclusion of today's meeting, I think that we have that there is a very high risk that alien disease can make something like this. In that area, removal of replanting ban, because I think that if we want to make experiment in the field. That's the only way we can do. And alternative, experimental mild containment measures. So this means that eradication, the grubbing up, can be sometimes an answer, but probably not for every situation. So we can try to make something different in order to try to learn how to live with the Xylella fastidiosa. But we also trust biodiversity. So infected areas must be seen like a unique opportunity to find answers to our own questions. Next most important EU challenge can start from this. And that's in the last slide, I decide to show you what we are seeing very frequently in Salento, where the olive trees in front is a cultivar lechino, and the other are totally dry, totally died. So this is just to say that we have we still have hope, but we have and we need to work together. We need because we have only one target, only one goal, and is the same for everyone. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Giovanni Cantele will be with us the whole meeting, and we'll have in the breakout groups other representatives of Copacogeca, ENA Plants, IFUAM. So the farmer organization are representing all the breakout session, and they will have the possibility to bring their needs for the research needs, which were shown in this slide. So we have space for one question, because we are running out of time. Aria Rice from European Commission, a question regarding research needs.
Well, I think representing here the European Commission, I think we have to. I don't want to start the debate. It's clearly on this point, but we have to take care of a few points. First of all, we have to be careful with saying that let's close our borders and not import any plant that might be vulnerable to a quarantine disease, because we would be very rapidly in big trouble in Europe as being big importers of food and plants. And another important point, an essential point here that we also linking to the previous presentation is, please let's not forget that we are not in the situation in Europe where California is or where Brazil is, where Xylella is a disease that is widely spread, and where the approach is to management. How do we live with this pest? In Europe, we should not try to live with this pest. Of course, there is an era in Europe now, South Puglia, where you cannot avoid anymore, and also we recognize this for containment, but we should invest with all means to stop the further spread, because we are not just responsible for one area, one province in Europe, but we have a responsibility for agriculture in Europe as a whole, in the EU. And there we should be very careful with approaches like pruning, which maybe in a containment environment is a good idea, but in where you really want to stop and to safeguard the rest of your territory that is still free from it, you have to be very careful with this approach. Just on the losses, that is something for which the Commission is open for discussion and to find the best solution, but we will try. On our side, there is a request, it was also presented here, that there should be research possible in the area where there is containment to try for trials, for example, for resistant varieties, etc. There's a point that certainly is going to take on board very shortly. Thank you.
I may, this is not a question, I imagine. I may have a question for you and or for everyone. Everyone has. Are we really sure that Xylella fastidiosa is not in more countries? So that's the big question, and I don't find totally balanced this kind of situation, because I totally agree with you that and I also state on my presentation that our first target, our first goal is to stop the spread of the breakout in order to avoid the problems to our own colleagues in the same region in Italy and in all Europe. But if I don't mistake, Xylella fastidiosa subspecies pauca arrives from a third country. So I think that it is not such a strange request for us if we say that it is important to have a proper control of the borders.
Thank you very much. So we will move to the next speaker. And Giovanni Cantele will be with us also in the breakout session. And also these issues for discussion can continue during the different sessions. Next speaker is Giovanni Baldissera. Giovanni Baldissera is Eofresco coordinator. Giovanni works for EPPO, the European Mediterranean Plant Protection Organization, and is coordinating the Eofresco activity. Eofresco is an organization of research managers and funders in plant health in Europe, a network of organization from different countries. So Giovanni will talk about research needs on Xylella fastidiosa from an Eofresco perspective. Thank you.
So thank you, the organizers, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to present the position of Eofresco members on Xylella fastidiosa. So just a couple of words on what is Eofresco, even if it was rapidly presented. So Eofresco, it's a network of research program owners and managers working in the phytosanitary area. It was initiated as a EU-funded ARANET, and as such, it has been working and is still working to reduce fragmentation of the research in Europe. Since 2006, Eofresco members have worked to coordinate national research programs, exchanging information on the national programs, and we will see later on how this information is important to optimize the use of resources. And Eofresco members have also been funding a number of transnational research projects. And this translates in a great sharing of information, development of a common research agenda, which is a supranational document containing recommendations on how to deal with strategic objectives for research in Europe. And 47 research projects have been funded so far. Since 2014, Eofresco has become a long-term sustainable network, and the members continue the activities of the ARANET, and in particular, the funding of transnational research projects. And already this year, Eofresco members have identified 18 research topics to be funded from an initial list of 62 national priorities. And among this project, and this is the reason why I'm standing here to present the network, it's because there is a research topic that will be funded on Xylella fastidiosa, harmonized protocol for monitoring and detection of Xylella fastidiosa in its host plant and its vectors. So the national suggestion was presented by Italy which is not a surprise. And this suggestion was rapidly endorsed by a number of other members. So all the green highlighted are the countries that are currently supporting the topic. As EUFRESCO, we try to coordinate among ourselves, but it's also important to coordinate with other initiatives. It has been said several times this morning, European research doesn't have to reinvent the wheel. And it is for this reason that we have the chance to have on board in the research project some non-EUFRESCO members. So the slide indicates once, but it's because the slide it's a little bit old. I had to send it a few days ago. So there are now three non-EUFRESCO members. So one, it's USDA Agricultural Research Service. Then there is Czech Republic that decided to join a couple of days ago. And also the CAM Bari will participate both in terms of research on diagnostic activities, but also very important as an organization that will transfer the knowledge and the outputs to the countries in North Africa. The idea is really to cover not only Europe, but the whole Mediterranean basin. At the beginning of the discussions of EUFRESCO member on the topic, a couple of gaps were identified. So the first one is the knowledge of vectors. We saw a couple of presentations this morning from people from America. So the bacterium has been there for some time, and there is a lot of knowledge around the vectors. This is not the case for Europe. And the second gap is represented by the diagnostic tools. A number of serological and molecular tools are available, but there are a few drawbacks around this test. Research is needed in this direction. And so, what is the overall goal of the EUFRESCO project is to monitor Xylella fastidiosa in both vectors and symptomatic and asymptomatic plants. And the expected results are protocols for sampling and processing material that will allow the isolation of viable cells. This is very important. The bacteria is called fastidiosa because it's difficult to culture, so it's important to have such tools. And also, the other expected result is the harmonization and validation of detection and identification methods. The funding of transnational research project is one of the activities of EUFRESCO, but I will say that this corollary to the main objective of the network, which is to coordinate research funding and research. And keeping that in mind, as EUFRESCO, we always try to fit and to link to the surrounding research panorama. And during the discussion, we all had in mind the need to cooperate with this EU-funded project, Ponte. We will know more in this in coming hours. So there are complementarities among the EUFRESCO project and the EU-funded project. First of all, the Ponte project is mainly focusing on olive and on the Codiro strain. What EUFRESCO members have decided is to take advantage of the variety, not only in terms of expertise and knowledge, but also in terms of interest. Different countries have different interests in terms of host species, in terms of vectors. And so the Eufresco project will cover a number of hosts, olive trees, vine, fruit trees, ornamentals. And there will be, again, complementarities in terms of the monitoring schemes that will be adapted to different host species, the sampling protocols that will be different according to the host species and to the vectors. And importantly, Eufresco members will try to validate diagnostic methods able to discriminate between the different subspecies. So if the European Union is a very important research funder, still there are other actors. And again, we also try to link and to exchange with these other actors. And so this map here, it's a map that I could draft thanks to the inventory that has been performed in the framework of Eufresco. So we have contacted 113 research program owners and managers in the EPO region, and we have asked them about their research project on Xylella fastidiosa. And so these are the countries that currently have or that will have in the next months project on Xylella fastidiosa. And so there is some diversity. So the Netherlands will focus on collection of isolates and characterization. This is very important, but also on the improvement of detection methods. The Belgium will be more interested on the biology of the bacterium into host plants, but also on vectoring capacities of different species. Italy is covering a lot of different activities. France, it's also interested in biology and in diagnostic, and Portugal, it's working on bioassay and resistance. And so it's good that we are here talking about what we are going to do as a funder, but I think you stand being in the audience, you need a take-home message, and this slide, it's, I think, the take-home message from the Eufresco members. So what still has to be done and what should be covered by those that are coming after the Eufresco project or the Ponte project? And again, I could got this information thanks to the feedbacks that I've received by Eufresco members, but also thanks to the discussion I had in the framework of the meeting of the EPO panel in diagnostic on bacteriology. And so characterization of isolates, it's very important. Data supporting risk identification, it's another priority. Sampling procedure and sample preparation because of the variety and the difficulties associated to the analysis of different matrices, it's also important. Eufresco will cover a part, but still there is room for other players. And at the very bottom, this was presented by Dr. Lopez. Control measures, it's still a lot to do. In particular, sustainable approaches are necessary, and the genetic improvement can be one. We are a network of research funders. We try to coordinate research. Research, it's at the foundation of what will get to the field. It's at the foundation of the knowledge that will allow us to cope with this disease. This is important, and we are available to discuss and to link with any initiative and any player in the field. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. There's space for one question. Any question on this? So it was very, one question from Sandy Purcell.
Yes, quick question. I'm a little confused. You said other, I think, funding sources, or maybe it meant that, if I understood correctly. I'm wondering about international programs like UNFAO, because all of North, all the countries that join the Mediterranean are vulnerable to this, not only as targets, but potential later sources of inoculum, so, and new strains, et cetera. So some kind of coordination at that level would be very important, I would think. And I wonder if you have any comment on that.
Yes, so I'm having discussion with people working at FAO. I have a very valuable colleague who is now working on the IPPC. So discussions are in progress in that direction.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So we will close today the morning session, and we will move this afternoon to the key business, which is divided into breakout session and discuss about research priority in the different areas. So if you can show the slides. So now we'll have 1 hour break. So after the lunch, you will find the indication to reach the different rooms. So those of you who are registered in the parallel session one on surveillance detection, we have to go to the room Bergen, which is a ground floor. You follow from the reception the sign for the conference center. Then the session two on vectors, identity, biology, epidemiology, and control will be on the third floor of the hotel. So you take the lift still near the reception, and there will be sign. You will go to room Narvik, but you will see sign. On the way, you will find sign for the room and for indication also of the session. Session three on plants or strange breeding for resistance certification will be in the ground floor. Again, from the reception, look for the conference center. It's on the other side of this room. And the room is room Lillehammer. And then you will have session four, again, on the third floor in room Skien. You will sign for all these rooms in the ground floor, and then near the elevator, and then at the floor. So I think now we should break for lunch. So there's a lunch for all participants organized at the restaurant of the hotel. So now we will be accompanied to our tables. So please bring away your computer from this room, because we will not come back here this afternoon.